is that? That's terrible. Ugh.
This is Hannibal Buress from HannibalTV.com with WWE Hall of Famer, first African-American tag team champions in WWE with Rocky Johnson. He's wrestled for Great North Wrestling. He's wrestled all over the world, Puerto Rico, two Hall of Fame rings. And he has promised me he's going to twerk in this interview. So stay tuned. He's going to twerk.
I'm going to show you all my wrinkles.
Let's see those guns. You were showing me them earlier. Yeah, you haven't missed any time in the gym, have you?
Oh, no. I'm gonna hit it in the morning, too. I work out like 4 days a week now, Hannibal. I go Monday, I do chest, shoulders, and tricep. I go Tuesday, do back, biceps. Of course, I do abs every day. And then on Wednesday is my leg day. And then on Friday, I do a total body workout from head to toe. That's where I hit everything twice. On my Friday workout, the only thing I do for my chest is just bench press. Then I do shoulder press. And then I do deadlift for my back. And then I do squats for my legs. And, of course, barbell curls and tricep extension.
Well, you look good.
Thank you, brother. But, you know, we have to stay healthy. We only get one body.
That is true. And you've lasted longer than a lot of wrestlers.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. You know, I do it because of, you know, good people like you and all the fans out there that encourage me when I go places to do autograph signing. People give me compliments and say, Tony, you know, you're staying in good shape. You look good, brother. Keep it up. And, you know, when people say stuff like that to you, it make you feel good.
There's a fan on here. By the way, there's going to be some fans tipping you today, Tony.
It's a bad
word. Carlos just tipped you $20, and he says you're one of the all-time greats, Carlos Ray.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he doesn't even have a question for you. He just wanted to give you a $20 tip.
Oh, Tim, thank you. I could use it.
Johnny has a question for you. He says, any chance of writing a second book? Your first one was very good. I agree. Your first one was excellent.
Well, I would love to do a second book if I could find somebody to write it, because believe it or not, there was a lot of stuff left out of the first book. I don't know if I told you this before, Hannibal, but when I was a kid, you know, I was talking to my buddy about child molestation, and I almost got molested twice when I was a kid. And when I told the guy about it, the guy that wrote my book, he said, well, we don't want to put that in there.
Oh, so you want to go in more details of all that stuff.
Right, about how it was. Because, see, my mother, when we grew up, mom worked all the time. And so my grandmother kept us. But, you know, grandma was old, so we slept away from her. Well, they had a lot of pedophiles and stuff in my neighborhood. And what made me think about it was when I hear the story about Marty Jannetty. When he told his story, you know. I didn't kill the guy because I was, like, between 6 and 8. But when I was 6, I almost got molested by a guy that worked for called the Big Brothers, you know. And then another guy pretended to be a policeman. He tried to molest me, but both times, you know, my brothers, my oldest brother, you know, they protected me both times. But I always thought, what would have happened to me if they wasn't around? And that what really got me into all this sports. I started my career with the Police Athletic League. I wanted to learn how to box, so I was a boxer up until about 19 years old. I started when I was 6, going to Police Athletic League. I went there all the way. Went there about 12 years, you know, I did the glove. And plus, I did amateur wrestling and weightlifting because I didn't want nobody taking advantage of me ever again.
And there's a couple more questions on here from the fans. M. Max says, Tony, are you ever going to come back to visit Roanoke, Virginia? I'm sure the mayor would love to have you here for a Tony Atlas Day.
I would love to do that. You tell them, just give me a call. You know, just contact Hannibal. Just tell them contact you and you set it up for me.
There you go. And I can be reached on Twitter at Devin Hannibal. Tony is on Twitter at Real Atlas, but he doesn't answer it. But maybe we can get this out of the way now. If someone wants a drawing from you, you do artwork or an autograph, where can they contact you to get that?
Well, I'll tell you the best way to do it is just to call Mike here. You know, Mike get me a lot of work. In fact, he just had me to do a drawing for for him. And he do a lot of work. And what they do, they send me a picture. I don't know if you can see it, but I'm trying to show it to you. Right there, I got ECW guys. See? Let me have that day, 11 by 17. You probably can see that butter. You probably can see the 11 by 17 butter because that's kind of big. See, now this is a print of the artwork. As you can see, I got Sabu, Tommy Dreamer, and the Sandman. And I just did this one for Mike here, and he loved it. But this is just a print. The original is 18 by 24. So all they do is just contract Mike, because Mike, he been doing that for me. So far, this is like the fourth drawing that he got for me. And Mike could tell you exactly what the deal is. You send your money, I'll PayPal him, and Mike would text me a picture. And I don't only just draw your favorite wrestler. I could put you in the picture with your wrestler. Like, let's say if you like Hulk Hogan or you like Bruiser Brody, then I could draw Bruiser Brody, and I could put you in the picture with Bruiser Brody. So it don't matter how many people are in the picture. I have done pictures that much of with nine people in it.
So where can they contact Mike? It's Mike Hamilton, right? Where can they reach him if they want to buy one of your things?
You just call Mike, tell him. Mike Hamilton.
Mike Hamilton on Facebook.
Yeah, Mike Hamilton on Facebook. He handled that stuff for me. Because I don't have no PayPal or nothing, you know.
Okay. Well, Tony Smith tipped you $10, and he has a question for you. He says, greetings from St. Louis. Any stories about Sam Mushnick? Also, he loves your artwork that you've done for Bruiser Brody.
Yeah, I do Bruiser Brody for television, Viceland TV. And I just did an Abdullah and Bruiser Brody for Mike. He contracted me to do one. And I enjoyed doing pictures of Bruiser Brody simply because, you know, it keeps him alive. You know, he died at a very young age. Unfortunately, he shouldn't have. I mean, it was horrible. He didn't die. He got murdered, to make it plain and simple. But yeah, Sam Musket, he was such a great promoter that people forgot the name of the building. When they talk about it, they say, you want to go see his show. So he was one of the all-time great promoter. Gave me a lot of advice when I first started off in my young career. Very nice, pleasant man. He spoke his man, shoot for the hip, you know, no bull crap. Wonderful gentleman.
And Road Warrior Animal recently passed away. I saw a video where it appeared something unusual happened with you in a match with the Road Warriors at one point. Was that just working, or was there some heat at one
point? Not Animal, it was Hawk. With Hawk, right?
With Hawk, yeah.
Yeah, well, see, the Road Warriors, when they first started, what they do, they would just go in and throw guys around. They didn't work with guys. I mean, they just beat the living crap out of you. Well, as you notice, as soon as Hawk got in the ring, Animal always been a businessman. Animal always been a good worker. He was the strongest of the two. He was the toughest of the two. But he was a businessman more than anything else. But Hawk was kind of like an animal. I mean, he just loved to fight. He was just a hard-nosed, rough, tough guy. And so he tried to intimidate his opponent before the match started. That way, they would let him do whatever he wanted to do to him. But then, once I'm not trying to blow my own horn, but at that time, for a guy that had a 650 bench, you can't intimidate that guy too much. So he couldn't intimidate me.
There's another fan question on here. He saw a match on YouTube where you fight Onita for the FMW title, and you had the ICW title in 1990, and he asked, what are your thoughts on Onita? Do you remember the match?
And No. Well, I'll tell you, Hannibal, I don't, but I'll tell you something that's so strange. A guy gave me a tape to watch. So I take the tape home and watch it. All the matches on the tape was me and Hacksaw Butch Reed. I don't even remember teaming with him. I must have got 10. Do you know I teamed with Hacksaw? You knew that? Where was that at? Was that World Class or Mid-South? Mid-South? Yeah, it was me and you know, and I could not remember teaming with him. Ain't that strange?
Well, I don't remember a lot of my matches. My career was a lot shorter than you, so I believe it.
Yeah, it's a lot of people I wrestled with, a team with, I don't remember. I mean, I remember the person, but I just don't remember the matches. There were just so many. See, we wrestled all day, what people don't realize. We wrestled every day, except for the only time we got off was 10 days before Christmas. We was off from the 15th of December until the 25th of December. The rest of the time, you know, we was on the road 24/7.
Krilling 876 to $2, and he says, do you have any memories of your feud with Ken Patera?
Oh, yes. I remember Ken Patera. We started our feud in Mid-Atlantic, our wrestling. And I beat Ken Patera, if people don't remember, I beat Ken Patera for the Mid-Atlantic Championship in Roanoke, Virginia. And then me and Patera, I went to WWF at that time, and then our feud continued. We were, you know, he was a very, very strong man, very strong man. So I remember just about every match I ever had with me and Ken Patera.
Iron Fist Films tips you $10, and he says he was trained to wrestle by King Kong Bundy, and he wonders if you have any stories about King Kong Bundy.
Yes, this is one that people don't know. I press slammed King Kong Bundy. He was not King Kong Bundy. He was wrestled as Chris. And it was in Allentown, Pennsylvania. In fact, I got a drawing of that I did. It was in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And he came down at what we call a jobber. In other words, he came there to put guys over. So McMahon wrote his name down, Vince McMahon Sr. They put Bundy in the ring. When Sue and Bundy went to the ring, all the wrestlers ran to the front door to look. And I remember SD kept saying, SD, especially Liver Joe, said, Boss Man would get him. Boss Man could lift him. Boss Man could get him up. Boss Man get him up. And I go, what the hell are they talking about? So then they announced me, Mr. USA, told me I came through the door, and I saw this 450-pound guy standing in the ring. So I said, oh, my God, they want me to press slam this guy? I said, they're just trying to make me look silly. So I get the wrestling bundle, and believe it or not, I saw the match on YouTube or one of them channels. We wrestled around. Bundy was taking hip toss, the backdrop, flying mirror. I mean, he flew around the ring like a guy 130 pounds. So I press slammed him, and Vince said, well, how do you get him up there, Tony? I said, well, he jumped up to here. All they had to do was lock him out. Then he said, he jumped all the way up. I said, he jumped up on top of my head. All I do was just do the lockout. And they never showed a match on TV. The match was never shown on TV. They sent Bundy away, and the next time I saw him, he came out with the bald head. But in the match, you see me wrestling, he had long hair. He had a gimmick kind of like the one-man gang gimmick.
Do you have any stories about wrestling at the Capitol Center outside of Washington, D.C., Kenneth wants to know?
I remember wrestling at the Capitol Center. I wrestled Hogan there. I wrestled a lot of people there. That was one of my favorite places. Believe it or not, that was one of my favorite places to wrestle, that and Baltimore. But the Capitol Center, I used to love. I'd rather wrestle at the Capitol Center than Madison Square Garden. It was just, the atmosphere was just much, much better.
Tommy in the Bronx tips you $50, and he says he met you a few times and you're a class act.
Well, I'm an act, all right.
Angel wants to know if Too Cold Scorpio was misused by WWE. And one more thing, any tips today are going to Tony for anyone just tuning in here. He's had a rough time for lockdown, so it's all appreciated. But any thoughts on Too Cold Scorpio?
Too Cold Scorpio, probably one of the people don't realize this. He probably one of the toughest wrestlers that this business ever seen. You know, he would train in Japan, and in Japan, as you know, they would beat the crap out of you. So when Too Cold first went over, they was kicking him from one end of the ring to the other. By the time Too Cold's left, he was kicking everybody else around the ring. But I think Too Cold Scorpio is mainly known for his third leg to make put his mouth in.
Yeah, I've heard the stories, but I'm more invested in the women's body parts than the men.
Oh, yeah, the women be hollering. You can hear them down in the lobby.
You got a $5 tip from Vera7331. He says he saw you wrestle Jesse Ventura in Boston in 82. Any thoughts on wrestling Jesse?
Jesse was the type of wrestler that before the ring, he would come up to you and say, "You know I was a Navy SEAL, don't you? I'm a tough guy because I used to be in a SEAL." But Jesse was the type of wrestler, he knew how to work the people. I put it this way, Jesse knew how to work without working. He told me one time, he said, "I don't take slams, I don't take backdrop, I don't take hip toss." He named every bump in the book. He said, "Did I leave anything out?" I said, "No, I think you covered it all." He said, "We're going to have a great match." And also, the funny thing about me and Jesse started his career. His first match was Omont Atlas was his first match. And Jesse lost by DQ. His last match was Tony Atlas in Winnipeg, Canada. And he lost by DQ. Now, is that strange?
Well, that's pretty interesting that you had his last match because he's one of the most successful wrestlers of all time, of course.
Yeah.
Governor and a movie star,
his
too.
His first match was in Winnipeg, Canada, and his last match was in Winnipeg, Canada.
Wow.
And
I hope to interview him one day.
Atlas was his first. Well, I learned about it from his book, Don't Have Time, No Time to Bleed. And he put that in his book that he started and ended his career with an Atlas.
I recall that now.
Yeah.
You mentioned that. I remember it now.
Yeah.
Tony Smith gets you $5 and he says, "Do you have any stories about Ernie the Cat Ladd?"
Yes. This is a story that all the wrestlers know. Ernie Ladd was wrestling Rocky Johnson in Florida. Well, Ernie was getting ready to leave the territory. So they want him to put Rocky Johnson over. They wanted a Rocky to win. So Ernie said, "I will lose as long as you don't film it and put on TV. Because if you lose in the arena, only the people in the arena get to see you losing. When you lose on TV, everybody in the whole state of Florida see you lose." And Ernie, that old time, didn't like losing on TV because they wanted to come back one day. They wanted to keep themselves good to come back. So anyway, Ernie was wrestling Rocky Johnson, and Ernie looked up, and he saw the little red light come up on the camera. So Ernie saw the light. He said, "They said they wasn't going to film the finish, and they filmed it." So what Ernie did was roll out of the ring and got counted out. So later on, they call Ernie. Ernie was supposed to leave the next morning. They call Ernie the Briscoe, Jack and Jerry Briscoe. And they told him to come down to the office. They want to talk to him. So Ernie, at 12 o'clock at night, went down to the office to talk to him. So they said, "Come on, Ernie, let's go take a ride." So they got the car with Ernie, drove around, and they were smoking pot. So they started talking about, "Ernie, you messed us up. You screwed us around. You know, we don't like that. You're supposed to do the job. You didn't do the job, blase, blase." So Ernie said, "Hey, let's not talk about wrestling no more." He said, "I got some real good stuff in the trunk of my car." Also, Ernie took his gun with him. He had a 38. He had his 38 with him, too. So Ernie went around the back of the car, and one of the Briscoe came to his right side, the other Briscoe came to his left side, and they tried to leg dive Ernie and take him down in the parking lot. Ernie pulled out the jack from the car, hit both of them in the head, and knocked them out. Then he started to leave them on the side of the road, but then Ernie started thinking they could get up and call the police and tell the police that I did this to him. So Ernie put him in the car, drove around until he found a policeman. He told the policeman, "These two guys tried to jump me," and the policeman ended up taking Jack and Jerry Briscoe to the place. But everybody know that story. Then there's another story about Ernie Ladd, Matt Bourne, and Hacksaw Jim Duggan got in a fight back in the back where Ernie had bad knees. And Ernie went to break up the fight. And his knee gave out on it. And I remember him saying, looking at me, go, "Tony Atlas, Tony Atlas. Yeah, yeah, I was down muscle there, Tony Atlas. Help me break up that fight, Tony Atlas. My knee is going on me. Will you help me out there, Tony Atlas?" So I went over to help him. Now, Bill Watts came back, found out that me and Ernie broke up the fight and told Ernie, if you break up another fight in my dressing room, you fire. He said, well, guys, get a fight and let them finish it.
Interesting. But, was there a lot of fights in your career that you saw in the dressing room, or was it rare?
Well, it wasn't so much in the dressing room. A lot of them was in the ring. I mean, I got into it with Saito in the ring because he wouldn't sell for me. We used to straighten guys out in the ring. We didn't, you know, because the heels and the babyface dressed in separate rooms back in them days. You know, so you had a heel dressing room, you had a babyface dressing room. So if you had a problem with a guy, 9 times out of 10, you sell it in the ring. Lars Anderson, I knocked him out in Mako Jordan, you know. So, yeah, guys would get stiff with you in the ring. If you couldn't do nothing about it, they would just beat the crap out of you right there in the ring.
Carlos tipped you another $20, and he said, it was sure great seeing you again. You look great. And Krilling 876 tipped you another $2, and he says, which opponent worked the crowd the best that you ever faced? Was it Macho Man or somebody else?
Dusty Rose. Gotta be Dusty Rose. Dusty Rose didn't do that much wrestling, if you stop and look at him. He just knew how to work the crowd. And next to Dusty Rose was probably, I would say, Hulk Hogan. See, a lot of guys get over like Bret the Hitman Hart. He never worked the crowd. Stone Cold Steve Austin never worked the crowd. They didn't have to. They knew how to work and get the crowd behind them through their wrestling. But you had a lot of guys that couldn't wrestle. Like, I didn't take of the two wrestlers, Dick Murdoch was an excellent wrestler. 3-time better than what Dusty Rhodes, but Dusty became bigger. Dory Funk Jr. was a better wrestler than Terry Funk Jr. But Terry Funk knew how to work the crowd and Dory didn't. So a lot of times your wrestling ability was not as good. And the only guy I say that could do both, knew how to work the crowd and could get himself over as a wrestler also, was Ric Flair. He had it going for both ends. And plus, he was a great interviewer. So Ric Flair was like, you know, everything. He had it all. He knew how to work in the ring. He knew how to work the crowd. He had a great interview. He knew how to sell. He knew how to get guys over. He knew how to get himself over. So Flair was, I would always say that Flair was always the best. Harley Race was probably a better wrestler than Flair, but Harley Race didn't have the charisma to go along with a Ric Flair.
Teddy Long did an interview with me about a month ago, and he said that in the past, Flair had called him the N-word. I know you said that you'd heard Flair using the N-word, but do you think he was actually racist, or was he just using a word that was more common back then? Because obviously he doesn't use that word anymore.
Well, you know how I feel about it. I think people calling people racist is getting kind of blown out of proportion. I mean, everybody probably had used that word sometime. It don't necessarily mean that they dislike Black people or that they racist or anything. I think racism is a thing that we put a lot of attention on that we don't need to, because the world is not the same. My wife is white. I see a lot of white and Black couples. We just had the first Black president of the United States. Right now, with the election, we just got the first Black woman vice president. I think the thing that we need to focus most on, not only in this country, but the world over, it's not so much racism, it's sexism.
Lewis wants to know what your thoughts are on Pat Patterson and the big scandal the WWE had with the Ring Boys and Mel Phillips and Terry Garvin and all them in the early 90s.
Well, it's hard for me to speak on that because me and SD, we didn't get involved in that stuff. We know we hear things of what was going on, so it's hard for me to talk about anything. You know me, Hannibal. If I have no first class, if I wasn't there or if I wasn't involved, then I don't like spreading rumors. You know, I hear stuff about what went on with Mel Phillips and Pat and, you know, and all them guys. But I was not involved in that homosexual world, so I just kind of kept my distance from it.
Now, you've talked to us in detail before about what happened in Puerto Rico with Brody, But Janelle wants to know, when you went back to work in Puerto Rico in later years, were you ever afraid something might happen to you?
No, I wouldn't say afraid, because see what happened, Carlos was trying to rebuild his territory. So for something else like that to happen, he knew he couldn't get away with it. Plus, it was no money involved. The Brody incident, I think Brody told me he invested $20,000. He bought Gorilla Monsoon shares. And so that was more about business and money and stuff like that. But no, I felt very safe there, because I think that the last thing that Carlos wanted was another scandal, because the world is different now. If he would have never got away with it today, because everything's on YouTube. That whole murder would have been on YouTube right now. Today, somebody would have filmed it. Somebody would have taped it. I mean, it would have spread all over the world. People didn't know about Brody murder, if you stop and think about it, to Vice TV. I mean, with 27 years went by before the world knew about the Bruiser Brody incident. 27 years before the world knew about it. So back, they would have known about it within 27 seconds if it happened today. So the world is different now. Everything you do, we have what we call the Unabomber. That guy escaped law enforcement for more than, what, 10, 15 years, sending out them bombs. Then we had the Boston Bomber. He got caught the same day. So it's different now.
There's a fan on here that wants to know if you have any Japan stories about the Iron Sheik, or any stories at all about the Iron Sheik.
Well, I remember one time we were sitting at breakfast, and they had this, what they call a shooter. I mean, one of the toughest shooters that this business ever had. His name was Carl Gotch, and everybody was scared of him. So Carl Gotch was just looking for somebody to show off on. So when I came in, he said, "Hey, one thing about all them weightlifters, they got pimps in that. He's nothing but a pinching that geek. Everybody got them, you know, got them big arms and big chest and all that. But he's a geek. I could stretch him, and within 2 minutes, all the guys that go lift them weights, they're nothing but wimp." The Iron Sheik was sitting with me. He said, "I go to the ring with the Mr. of a USA of an Atlas, and I lift the weights, or with a Tony Atlas, and I like to lift the weights. You want to say the weightlifter is no good? You try the Sheik, Mr. Gotch. You come on. You try the Sheik." Carl Gotch back down.
Wow, that's pretty crazy.
He didn't want, and Carl Gotch was one of the most fierce men ever been in this business. That's why he never made no money, because he just wanted to stretch and beat up on people. I mean, he'd go over to Japan just to beat up on a guy. Carl Gotch was one of the, he was an animal. But I remember the Sheik challenging him, and he backed down.
Interesting.
In Japan. That was in Japan.
Mike wants to know what your thoughts are on the recent passing of Kamala.
Kamala, I wish that if he passed, that he had passed happy, but I don't think Kamala been a happy man for a long, long time. I mean, it was just one bad thing right out of the first, you know, he get diabetes and lose both legs. And he wasn't getting booked that much, so he wasn't working that often. He didn't want to be seen out in public because of the loss of his legs. And then I don't think he died happy. That would make me sad. You know, there was no happiness in his life after he left the WWF. There was no happiness in his life. So he died a sad man. He wanted the saddest death that I knew, you know.
Now, I know you used to date one of the girls that also used to date Jimmy Snuka. Jesse wants to know what your thoughts are on the murder of Jimmy Snuka, and if you've seen the Dark Side of the Ring documentary on that.
Well, it wasn't a murder, I would say. It was an accident. You know, I wasn't there in the room, but I date a girl named Lisa. She was my second wife. And she was in the room, she told me, with Snuka. And what happened was they sent her and that girl to get some crack cocaine for Snuka. Well, they came back empty-handed because the dealer said he don't sell after 12 o'clock. Snuka was coming down. He did an 8-ball that day. The 8-ball is 3.5 grams of coke. So he was high as hell that day. They worked that big angle with Piper and Snuka and all that stuff. You know, they were really pushing Snuka. So he came up off the bed and he hit her. and she fell to the floor. He killed her with one punch. He didn't mean to do it, but he beat her up the week before the cops had to call. He jumped on her the week before over the same thing. He wanted to go get him some dope, and she wouldn't go get it. So this time she did get it, but she came back empty-handed, so he just lost it.
And unfortunately, earlier this year, your tag team partner, Rocky Johnson, passed away. Do you have any thoughts on his passing? And did you happen to attend his funeral, which I understand there was
by invitation on it, and I was not invited.
Okay, so you weren't invited.
I was not invited, no.
Oh. Were you surprised that he passed away? Because I know you would see him.
Yes, because I talked to Rocket about 3 days before. He kept coughing. I said, Rocket, you should go to the doctor. He said, I went to the doctor. They don't know what it is. That's what he told me. They don't know what it is. Then the funny thing about it, right after Rocket passed away, the coronavirus came out. So this is just my belief. I think he caught that virus.
That could be possible. Did you hear about everything that happened at his funeral?
I heard that Pat and Vince did not have nothing good to say about him.
Yeah, I mean, I only heard that secondhand, but that's what I heard from some people that were there. So it was unusual.
Yeah, well, they were not the best of friends anyway, if you stop and think about it. When me and Rocket lost the title, they never brought Rocket back for nothing. They never used him. Rocket career ended right after we lost the belt. I think it was in 83. Rocket was in the best shape of his life, and Vince cut him loose. And, you know, I stayed there all the way up until about 87, you know, or so before I left. But Rocket came back when we lost the belt. He told Vince, he said, I'm not going to let you make a jobber out of me like you did SD Jones. And he left. And they never called Rocket back for anything, except for the 1997, they brought him back when they were doing a little skit with his son. But other than that, if you stop and think about it, they never invite Rocket for anything. I mean, they brought me back to do stuff. Legend House, managed Mark Henry, Saba Simba. I mean, I got brought back several times, but Rocket was never brought back. They just cut him off.
Conspiracy 515 tips you $5. He says, where did your whole foot fetish come from? I don't think it's a foot fetish. I think it's a running shoe thing, but where did that originate from?
Well, having a fetish is something started when you was a kid. See, now I don't know this for sure, but I was talking to this guy and taking up this psychology stuff, and this is what he told me. See, I came from a family of 9 kids. 5 boys and 4 girls. If you got one meal a day, you was lucky. I didn't start walking until I was 3 years old. So I was always crawling around the floor. So I was always and it was mostly in the black neighborhood, the men impregnate the women and then they leave. So most black men in America are raised by a woman. So it was always women's around. My mother told me, she said, every time I call on you, you would curl up underneath somebody's feet. So I think a whole lot of stuff that we do came from what happened to you as a child. You know, most of your serial killers and stuff, something they had an incident when they was a child that caused them to do this. Most of your rapists and even some people that participate in the homosexual community. Some is born homosexual, but there's a lot of one that picked it up. You know, they probably went to jail or they got funnel riff when they was a child that caused them, you know, to do that. And I think that's what they're going to say. Somebody is bisexual. He was born to be straight, but because he has some involvement with his own sex at a very, very young age, that he got to enjoy that side of the fence too. So I think a lot of this stuff is stand for how a child is raised, you know, your upbringing. You're like me almost being molested. It was got me into sport. I wanted to learn how to defend myself. I wanted to be big and strong so people don't mess with me. I didn't want to get raped by no man, which almost happened to me twice.
Stephen Parker wants to know if you have any good stories from WWE Legend House.
Not good. I don't have no good one, no.
Any,
the only good part about it was the paycheck.
I can imagine. It would be a nightmare. It sounds like an absolute nightmare. Didn't Roddy Piper escape at one point?
Well, see, what Viz did, he put all the people together that he know didn't get along. That was the idea. We didn't know each other. I didn't know anything about Piper. Nothing. I knew nothing about Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Nothing about Jimmy Hart. I never spent more than 5 minutes with anybody in my whole life that was on Legend Out. We was all complete strangers to each other. See, people think because you're in the business, you know this guy. Well, they had cliques. Guys would travel with certain people. If you didn't travel with this guy, you didn't know what this guy did if you didn't travel with him. And I was mostly a loner because I was all into the weightlifting and all this and that stuff. So on my schedule, if you stay with Tony Atlas, I don't get up that early no more. I used to get up at 6 in the morning. At 7, I was in the gym. By 9 o'clock, I would have my breakfast. Now, so you stay with Tony Atlas, you got to get used to getting up at 4, 5, 6 o'clock in the morning and going to the gym. You know, I didn't go out to clubs that much. You know, I was a gym rat. So the only guy that would hang around me was guy that liked to go to the gym. And there wasn't many back in them days.
Michael Allen Rubin wants to know, what was it like working with Buzz Sawyer? Is he a legit tough guy?
Well, see, that's another thing. Buzz Sawyer was a heel. So the only time I got to be with Buzz Sawyer was in the ring. See, the heels and the babyface didn't travel together. That's why I didn't know Piper. He was a heel. That's why I didn't know Jim Duggan. He was a heel. That's why I didn't know Jimmy Hart, because he was a heel manager. Pat Patterson was a heel. Me and Hillbilly Jim was only babyfaces in that whole thing. And then Howard was an office person, so Howard worked in office. So the only babyface in Legend House was me and Hillbilly. That's why we got along, because we knew each other a little bit before we got there. But heels and babyface, people always ask me about these heels. I knew nothing about them. We couldn't hang around them. You got five that catch you with a heel. One time, Wahoo McDaniel and Ric Flair were riding together in the same car, and George Scott fired him. Wow. But he brought him back because he had to, because of the house, you know?
Interesting. There's a fan on here that wanted to know if you ever wrestled Bad News Brown.
No.
What were your thoughts on him? I guess you never met him.
I didn't know him that well. He mostly stayed in Japan a lot. I met him a couple of times, but I think Brand New Brown came to WCW or WWE during the time that I was doing the independence. But I think I met him maybe about twice my whole life. I probably seen him about twice my whole life.
Michael Allen Rubin wants to know, who is the stiffest wrestler you ever worked? Oh, we may have lost him for a second. We'll get him back. I think he just froze, guys. Thank you so far for the tips. They're all going to Tony. And of course, with this lockdown.
Well, I didn't hear that.
Oh, he's back.
You break it up on me.
Sorry, I'll ask again. Who was the stiffest wrestler you ever worked?
Going on there. Can you see me now?
Yeah.
Okay, we back.
Michael Allen Rubin wants to know, who was the stiffest wrestler you were ever in the ring with?
Well, see, back in the olden days, every wrestler you wrestle was stiff. Our job was to make the people believe. I hit Gene Anderson one time in the ring with an elbow. Give him an elbow. He told me, now excuse the expression, but I'm going to tell you exactly how Gene told me. He said, you fucking cunt, you, with them big arms, is that as hard as you can hit? Hit me. So I drew back and hit him as hard as I could. He said, oh, yeah, there you go, kid. Lay him in. Lay him in. The guy used to lay him in. If you look at Ric Flair, he stayed wrestle old school. The guy said, if you don't feel it, don't sell it. That's just all the guys were stiff back then. We had no loose wrestler. The looseness started with the independent worker. That's when everything got loose. But with the old timer, they all were stiff. There were no such thing as too stiff in the ring. We used to call stiff. Stiff to us was when a guy refused something. That was stiff with us. But all the guys worked slug, they worked tight, and they laid in their chops.
Now the fans think it's a botch if it's stiff, but in reality, it's well,
the guys now, Hannibal, are a lot softer now. You know, they soft as a grape, some of these guys. They've never been hit, really hit. And if you hit most of them, they call that stiff. That's not stiff. We just call that lay it in. Stiff is when a guy started to shoot with you. That's stiff. That's what stiff means.
There's a Dino Bravo fan on here that says he heard you say you saw Dino bench 495. Do you know if he ever got a higher number on the bench press than 500?
He had a blockage. He would bench press. It was in Georgia. Me and him was working out. And he went up to 495. Well, I put them little 2.5 on there. And he couldn't get it off his chest. Just that 2. It was something about once you told him it was 500, he just couldn't do it. It was a blockage. But later on, he broke that. And then, as y'all know, he did a hell of a lot more than that after that.
Brad wants to know if you liked the way that MTV portrayed you in the documentary that they did about you.
You talk about the wrestling?
The MTV, did you like the way that they presented you in that documentary?
Oh, yeah, well, they just filmed what they saw. I mean, you know, if I didn't do it, they couldn't film it. So they didn't. See, I wasn't supposed to be on that. What happened, my money man walked out on me on the show. So MTV wanted to film training to be a wrestler, independent wrestling, and then the big leagues. But what ended up happening was, because he couldn't have filmed the independent guy, they decided to do a document on after the glory. So that was my share, was after the glory. But that was not their plan at first. It was what they did to follow up on the guy canceling 3 shows on him on the independent. They wanted to show the independent wrestlers. I asked them, I said, can I be on it? They told me no.
So it worked out better for you.
Yeah, but I wish they had went the other way, because all people already knew me, but there was so many great kids at that time, the talented kids that didn't get that break. They should have had that break. So I don't feel good about taking that away from them kids, you know?
There's a fan on here that wants to know why you think Vince gave you that Saba Simba character that was short-lived.
Well, I'm not a man reader, so I really couldn't answer that question. But I don't regret it, because right before Saba Simba, a lot of people don't know, I was sleeping in Kennedy Park. I was homeless. I lost everything I had. You know, I was sleeping in the park. And then when I met my wife, Monica, she took me out of the park, took me home, washed me off, dusted me off, and gave me a new start in life. She saved my life. And then about a year after living with my wife, Monica, we wasn't married then, Vince called me to do Saba Simba. And then when I left Saba Simba, my wife saved my money for me. I was able to go back to school and become a certified personal trainer. So it all worked out. So regardless of what people think about it, in the long run, it was long enough. Because after Saba Simba, I even got a little run down there with Cactus Jack and Barbarian down in WCW. So it all worked out. It got me back in TV, got people, you know, using me again, you know. So it wasn't bad, even though it was short run, but it was long enough for me.
Eric tips you $2, and he wants to know what wrestler got the most ladies.
Oh, who?
Eric, he's wondering what wrestler had the most girls.
Oh, my goodness. That's hard to say. We all did. It was, if I would say everybody was equal, even you was ugly, fat, and out of shape, you got the women's. You was a wrestler. You got to realize, back in the olden days, when we was wrestling, they only had maybe, 4 TV stations? So if you was on one of the 4 stations, back then you was a big deal. Now you got over 100 TV stations. So being on TV now is not as glamorous as it was back. Anybody could be on TV now. Anybody could be on TV then. But you had to be something special to be on TV in the 70s, you know, before cable television. So you only had like 4 or 5 stations. You had ABC, NBC, CBS, and public broadcast. And the only cable during that time was HBO, and then Ted Turner had the first cable station, you know, TBS. But if you was on NNM TV back in them days, you was a big shot. Everybody didn't get on TV back then. If you was on TV, it was the news, but you didn't want to be on the news because you did something wrong. You're going to jail.
Long Duck Dong tips you $5 and he says, have you ever thought about starting a real wrestling federation like wrestling used to be back in the old days? Because we sure could use some of that right about now.
There's only one way of doing that. Every match gotta be the same. The philosophy gotta be the same in every match. The promoter have to take control of the show. You have to toughen the guys up to do a real match. They had to get toughened up where they could do a real match. Secondly, the guys had to be believable. You know, you can't put a guy in the ring and he run across the ring and his chest and his stomach is bouncing around like Jell-O. And you know, you can't. You, in other words, it's hard to do a federation when you allow anything to get in your ring. You know, today they wouldn't let just anybody in the ring. They wouldn't do that. They wouldn't let just anybody in the business. So, yes, you could do that. You have to pretty much train them to do it 80% real. What they do got to be 80% real with a little bit of work in it. That's how we did it. Most of the matches were, well, I mean, when I wrestled Johnny Valentine, I didn't felt like it was a work. I felt like I was in a fight of my life. With Greg Valentine, it's like that now. When you wrestle Greg Valentine, you feel like you're in a real fight. And that's how most of the matches was back in them days. And that's why people couldn't see through it.
Rob tips you $5, and he's wondering if you have any Dominic DiNucci stories.
That Dominic DiNucci did what?
This guy, Rob, tips you $5, and he just wants to know if you have any stories about Dominic DiNucci.
The only thing I knew about Dominic DiNucci that the world don't know, that he was Olympic wrestling champion. And that's something nobody knows. He was an Olympic wrestling champion. He won the Olympics, I think, in the 50s or something. He was a champion, Olympic champion in wrestling.
John tipped you $5, and he said, how long did you actually live in Rhine Oak, Virginia for?
Who?
John tips you $5, and he's wondering how many years you actually lived in Rhine Oak for.
I live in Roanoke?
Roanoke, yeah. Sorry, I'm pronouncing it wrong.
I went to Roanoke when I was 14, and I stayed there until I was 21. I was raised in Clifton Forge. I was raised up in Lowmore, Virginia. Born in Clifton Forge, raised in Lowmore, Virginia. But they always announced me for Roanoke because it was a big town. The town I was raised up in had one store, the commissary, and it was ran by the railroad. I'm a country boy.
VO tips you $9.99. He wants to know what your favorite steroid is.
My favorite what?
He wants to know, I don't know if you ever took steroids, but he wants to know what your favorite steroid was.
Only, the steroid we used for competition only. All the guys that built up off of steroids, they don't have muscles now. And they're not living now. So I didn't have a favorite steroid. Steroid was just something that guys used to give that little edge. In my day, I don't know what they use it for now, but in my day, give you a little edge. Like if I'm going to a bodybuilding contest and I weigh about 260, well, I'm going to have to diet down to get cut. Well, without the juice, when I walk on stage, I'm going to be about maybe 210. With the juice, I walk on stage, I'm going to be a product. If I'm with 260, I'm going to walk on stage about 240. And for a bench press is concerned, without the steroid, I'm going to do maybe 550 on the bench. I had a natural 550 bench anyway. With the steroid, I probably get another 50 pounds. So they don't make that much difference in the development. You still have to do the work.
Lombardi 1969 wants to know, what are your memories of Fritz Von Erich?
Oh, people love to ask me something that happened 50 years ago, don't they? Well, I know as much about Fritz. Like I said, y'all asked me about heels again. I was a baby face. Nobody cares about the baby face. They always ask me about heel. I didn't travel with Fritz. He was a heel. We couldn't be around him.
I see.
See, that's how Hannibal, they had a dressing room for the heels. They had another dressing room for the baby face. Remember, our job was to make the people believe. So if I was hanging around Fritz Von Erich, to them, I was exposing the business. You understand what I'm saying? So you couldn't hang around a heel. That's why Abdullah was not in the dressing room when Brody got stabbed, because Abdullah was a heel and Brody, they turned him babyface. He was a heel, but then they turned him babyface. So he was in a babyface dressing room. We didn't come out the same door like they do now. The heel, they had a heel come out the one door, the babyface come out the other. You couldn't travel together. You couldn't even stay in the same hotel where we used to race. If we had a good hotel, we used to race to get there and see who get there first. If I see Ric Flair stand at desk checking into this hotel, I go to the next hotel. If I walk to a restaurant, I saw Ric Flair in that restaurant eating, I go to another restaurant. We was not allowed to be around each other. So you have to ask a heel about a heel in my day.
Eric took $5 and he wants to know if the wrestlers back in the older days were ever afraid of catching STDs from ring rats.
I don't like them using the term ring rats because I think that's a put down to the women, because the biggest dogs was the wrestlers. So we were the ring rats, not the women. Them women, they were with one wrestler and they waited and they would do anything for this wrestler. But that wrestler, he was with this woman in Winston-Salem, another woman in Charlotte, another woman in Roanoke. They was with a different woman every night of the week. But yet they called the women they was with rats, because the women were fascinated with them. So I don't think them degrading them women, because a lot of these women that dated wrestlers, they living now. They got kids. They got grandkids. And every time a wrestler called them a ring rat, I wonder how that woman felt that she fell for this wrestler who just used her for her body and kicked her to the curb and now calling her name. That's why I don't like use that term, ring rats.
Long Duck Dong tips you another $2 and he says that you are a true legend. And Ryan Butler tips you $5. He says, what's the worst injury you ever had, and how do you continue being in such great shape?
The worst injury?
Yeah.
I broke my neck.
Wow, how did that happen? That's crazy.
Tommy Rich flipped the car 3 times. He flipped it 3 times, broke my neck. Tommy Wildfire Rich.
So it wasn't in the ring, it was outside the ring. How long was the recovery period?
Yeah. Well, I wasn't out long at all. I mean, I was out. I wrestled with a broken neck. You couldn't take time off back then. I still had to make the shows. I was in the hospital about a week. They put a halo on. Oldie said, take that damn thing off your head. They put me back in the ring. I just had to be careful, that's all. But I couldn't miss. I was already booked. So, you know, broken neck, broken leg, that's no excuse not to make the show, not in them days. If you don't make the show, they just replace you.
Do you think a lot of the wrestlers today signed with the big companies are kind of whiners? Because right now, they only wrestle one day a week. They have guaranteed contracts, medical people in the back, catering, which you guys didn't have a lot of the time. Like, what do you find about the attitudes of a lot of today's wrestlers who still complain, even though they're not easy?
First of all, they're not wrestlers. They're sports entertainers. They look at it as an entertainer. They're not wrestlers. Wrestlers are gone. It's over with. Done. finished. Everybody now look at it as an entertainment, sports entertainment. They don't wrestle. I mean, how can you call it a wrestling match if you never grab a wrestling hold? It's all high spots. Nobody wrestle no more. When last time you saw a wrestling match, think about it, where guys got out there really wrestling, grab a headlock, grab a wrist lock, take over. You know, nobody do that no more. They do high spots and they chop meat. That's what we used to call it, chopping meat and high spots. Nobody wrestles anymore.
Rob tips you $5 and he says, what was it like wrestling in the Boston Garden?
In the Boston Garden?
Yes.
The worst freaking place in the world to wrestle in. They just shoot hot pennants. They get that ribbit gun. They would shoot hot pennants in the ring on you. They would spit on you. They would throw urine on you. You had gigantic rats that big. You're talking about arena rats. These were real arena rats. You know what I'm saying? With teeth and long tail, you know. And it smelled like somebody used the bathroom all the time. And the fans were the meanest damn fans you ever want to see in your life.
All right. Well, I've been in some arenas like that where it smells like someone's sure. in the bathroom all the time, too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the Garden was something. They had these gigantic rats used to run around all the time. And the fans were rowdy, brother. If they didn't like you as a heel, they would throw urine on you. They would spit on you. They would shoot hot rivet. None of the guys liked wrestling in Boston. That was the town all the wrestlers hated to go. The best place was like the Capitol Center or the place. But when you went to Boston, you know what was that? Thunderdome? What was that thing they had? Mad Max?
Yeah, Mad Max, the movie?
Yeah, that's what Boston got. That was it right there. That was it. Mad Max, the movie. In fact, I think somebody went to the match in Boston Garden and made a movie from it.
Now, there's another $5 tip here for collecting cardboard. He says, thanks for the memories. You and Rocky were the first WWE Black Tag Champs. I rooted for you when you got tuned into wrestling in 83. You didn't
have
a tip. Mark.
Thank you.
Mark also tips you $5, and he says, if you and Rocky Johnson would have stayed together, do you think you guys would have been the most popular tag team of all time?
Yes.
There you go.
But it wasn't up to us. You know that.
No. And Super Liger tipped you $1.99, too. So little tips here and there. Some more, another $1.49 tip. You're getting tips here and there. James wants to know if you enjoyed working with Abraham Washington in WWE.
Yes, I did. Abraham Washington, he's a great guy. It was fun. It gave me a different revenue. You know, I like wearing that suit every day. It made me feel important. No, it was fun. It was easy money. I was laughing all the way to the bank. I laugh all the way to the bank, brother. I mean, who can ask for a better job? I got paid to laugh.
That's excellent.
Come on, brother. You've been paid to laugh.
Matt wants to know, which wrestler did you draw the best with as far as which wrestler did you make the most money with?
Harley Race and Abdullah the Butcher. And Tommy Wildfire Rich. Tommy Rich, Harley Race, and Abdullah the Butcher were the people I drew the most money with.
Conspiracy 515 tips you $5. He says, after listening to New Jack throw it around without evidence, I'm curious, what would you consider being an Uncle Tom and sports entertainment?
What'd you say about New Jack now?
I guess New Jack called you an Uncle Tom. I don't even know what that word means, but I guess it's some type of...
Uncle Tom is a black person that get along with white people.
Okay, so this...
Yes, I like white people.
This person...
So I'm Uncle Tom, yeah.
...is asking what you think of New Jack calling you that.
I think he's a prick. He's a racist, low-life prick. Period. Talk about racism. See, when people talk about racism, you're always looking at white people. There's more racist black than are whites. I live in an all-white neighborhood in Maine. 98% of my state is white. In the town I live in, outside of the Somalia, but American blacks in my town, there's six of us. I have no fear, none whatsoever. You move into a black neighborhood and see if you got fear or not. So there's more racism in the black neighborhood than are in the white neighborhood.
Super Lager tips you $2. He wants to know how tough was Antonio Inoki.
Antonio Inoki did what?
He wants to know if you think Antonio Inoki was tough.
Oh, hell yeah. He wouldn't have been in the ring with Ali if it wasn't. That's why they put him in there. But somebody played a joke on. They went to Ali and told him Inoki going to take him down and break his leg. And then they told Inoki that Ali going to try to sucker punch him and knock him out. And that's what messed up the match.
Okay, I see.
Yeah. $1 million on hand, and some guy going to play a joke, and the two guys went for it. Because they was afraid of each other. Ali was afraid of Inoki, because Ali got in the ring with Gorilla Monsoon, so he know what a wrestler could do to him. You ever saw that tape of Monsoon did to him?
No, I didn't.
It's on YouTube. Go on YouTube and type in Gorilla Monsoon versus Muhammad Ali. Ali didn't last more than a sucker once Monsoon got his hands on him.
There's another fan on here that wants to know what your feelings are on Ahmed Johnson. I don't know if you ever met him or not.
I met him. Like I said, he was a heel. See?
Yeah.
Y'all ask me about these heels again. In my day, I couldn't socialize with them guys.
I see. Michael wants to know your feelings on Angelo Mosca, who you had a bunch of matches with.
Angelo Mosca was a bully. And if you let him, he would bully you. The best way to get along with Angelo Mosca is do not let him bully you. You know? And he tried to bully me a couple of times. It didn't work in his favor. So he kind of gave up on that idea over a period of time. And then later on, but Andrew Bosco was an asshole, bottom line.
Mark wants to know if you've ever wrestled in Britain, in the United Kingdom.
Oh, many times, yep. I wrestled all over Europe, Asia. I wrestled all over the world.
What's your favorite city to wrestle in?
My favorite place to wrestle?
Yeah.
Germany.
Oh, interesting.
Germany, yeah.
Why is that?
The response of the people. See, there are not many African Americans in Germany. And they just, you know, I'm something special to them there. You know, when you go to any country that they don't have black people, you kind of special, you know. And Germany really respect athleticism. So my physique got over real good in Germany. You know, real good.
Well, at one point, they didn't like black people too much there, but I guess they had a change of heart.
Where?
In Germany, back in the Second World War, at one point, they were really much against other races.
Well, we were too. Remember segregation?
Yeah.
Jim Crow? We were too.
For sure. Preston
Gate. It wasn't just Germany, brother. I mean, you got to realize, we didn't desegregate until 1970. Germany started liking black long before America did. And Germany never had slaves. We are a 400-year-old country. We had slaves for 350 years. And then we did 100 years of Jim Crow. So we can't talk about nobody. Trust me on that one. We slaughtered the American Indians. We the only person in the world that ever dropped a nuclear bomb on human beings.
True.
No, I can't talk about it. Hey, it's like the pot calling the kettle black. We all got a little, you know, I wash my hands in muddy water. Try to do what my daddy told me, but I guess I must wash my hand in a muddy stream. We all got a little dirt on our hand. Nobody could talk about nobody. That Jesus said, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. We can't throw stone. People in glass houses cannot throw stone. We tried to beat up you Canadians in the War of 1812 to take Columbia from you. Remember that? Y'all whooped our ass if we didn't get that.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was that, 1812? We tried to take up, what was it, around Washington, Oregon, that area there. We want to take that part. What was that, Columbia? Is that on the northern, the western part of Canada? West of Canada?
I really did not pay any attention at school. I know very little about it.
Oh, that's your history, brother. Yeah, y'all whooped our butt in that war. We tried to move more north.
Yeah.
Y'all stopped us in our track. In fact, the state that I live at, Massachusetts, everything past Bangor used to belong to Canada. If you look at where I live, I really live in Canada. Because on the east, if I go east, I'm in Nova Scotia. If I go west, I'm in Quebec. You understand?
Yeah, true.
I'm surrounded by Maine. It's surrounded by Canada. The only way I could get out of Maine without going to Canada is to go south. If I go north, I'm in Canada. If I go east, I'm in Canada. If I go west, I'm in Canada. The only way that I can leave Maine is to go south. In fact, Nova Scotia is south of Maine when you look at it on the map.
Does WWE still come to Maine? I remember they used to do.
Nobody come to Maine anymore. I mean, nobody run matches up in anymore. It just died out, you know? They got a guy called Larry Hunter. He do a little bit here and there, but it's nobody with no big money that came in Maine for a long time.
Preston Davis has took $15. He said one of the greats. He says, how much for a private wrestling lesson?
Well, they got a lot of wrestling schools down there, but in order for me to go all the way to Canada to train somebody, it'd be hard due to the fact of where he's at, you know? If he was in Maine, it'd be a lot easier for me to train. It's hard for me to train somebody that's not close by me.
Yeah, that could be difficult. And personal training people too, right? Are you still able to do your regular job?
Yeah. I work at the Auburn YMCA in Auburn, Maine. I'm a personal trainer at the YMCA.
There's a fan on here that wants to know what's the funniest rib you ever saw, and he says he saw the wrestle a bunch of times in Maryland.
I kind of stayed away from that stuff because I didn't like it because I never liked making fun of someone else at their expense. So I didn't get involved in the ribs because once you start doing it to other people, they're gonna be doing it to you. So the old timer taught me to stay away from a guy that did ribs to people. So I didn't do much of that.
Is it true that Andre the Giant had beat with Big John Studd backstage?
Yes, he did because they kept calling Big John Studd the Giant, and that used to piss Andre off. Andre said only one Giant, Andre. But John Studd never did nothing to Andre. It's just that they called him the Jank, and that pissed Andre off, you know? It's just like if somebody else calls somebody else Mr. USA, it's not going to make me happy, you know?
Yeah, I understand that. There's been a bunch
of guys gimmick away.
A bunch of fans on here tonight have wanted to know your thoughts on AEW. Have you seen any of it?
Yes, I did.
And what do you think? It doesn't sound like the type of wrestling that you like.
Well, I see Cody doing the same thing that Dusty Rhodes did. He built the territory around him. And once the promoter put himself in the ring, he will allow no other wrestler to rise above him. That's the problem when you try to promote, book, and wrestle too. You're going to center everything around you. And I think in order for AEW to succeed, Cody is going to have to decide he want to be a wrestler or he's going to be a promoter. But there's a lot of talent that Cody and them going to overlook because he's going to keep everything built around him. And you shouldn't do that. That's why Vince was so successful. Vince wanted to go into the ring, but his father would not let him because his father knew once he became a wrestler, he's going to put everything built around him. Jerry the King Lawler was the only one that was successful with that. He was able to promote and wrestle too. But you take like Dusty killed more talent than he built. He used, you know, a lot of people that never got a break in his business because of his father. His father was the same way. He built everything around Dustin, you know. And then when Dustin went down to WCW and Bill Watts was in WCW, they put their sons on top. Nick Goudis put his sons on top. Whenever you got a family business like that, like the Von Erich kill, you know, they was always on top. Nobody got bigger than the Von Erich. So I saw this not just with certain people. I saw it with a lot of people. You know, they just ain't going to let nobody get bigger than them. And Cody is not going to let anybody in AEW get bigger than Cody.
How did you personally get along with Dusty during your interactions with him over the years?
I got along great with him. I love Dusty to death. I love him to death. He never did me no harm, but I just knew his tactics. Let's put it that way. I knew his tactics. We all knew what each other do. We didn't dislike a person. We thought he was pretty smart that he knew how to take care of himself. You know, we just wished that we was in a position where we could take care of ourselves the way Dusty did. So I had no bad feeling about Dusty. I love Dusty Rhodes to death. He was one of my best friends.
There's a fan on here, Sean, that wants to know what your favorite year was in the wrestling business for yourself.
The first year is always your best.
Really? Well, not for me.
But stop and think about it. You got a little old country boy from the hills of Virginia. The biggest, the most money I ever had in my pocket in one time was $50. And now I was walking around with $2,000 or $3,000 in my pocket every day.
Yeah, that's pretty damn good
money. Yeah. I mean, you know, you have to look at it. So for, in my time, that was the most important thing. I couldn't believe when I first walked into that ring that I was athlete or professional wrestler. And then to hear people cheer for you for the first time in your life. You know, people cheering for you, patting you on the back, telling you how great you are. You know what that feel like, your first day of it?
Oh, it feels amazing.
Yeah, especially in them days because they didn't have independent show. These were big shows, arena shows. So, I mean, you know, I was in the Charlotte Civic Center, the Atlanta Omni, Madison Square Garden, and all these places with 20,000 people cheering your name and patting you on the back and women's fighting to get to you. I mean, my goodness, think about that.
Yeah, those were the good old days. I wish I was.
Yeah, man, it was amazing.
Gregory said you are the pride of Patrick Henry High School in Roanoke, Virginia. Do you have any story in that town that you could share? Obviously,
well, I was on the wrestling team, and so the whole time that I was there in Patrick Henry, main thing I would do was try to get my classes because that Patrick Henry where they just started integrating the schools. So I was there when they first integrated schools. So there was a lot of trouble between black and white that first year. By my senior year, black and whites was able to get along with each other a little bit. But it was a lot of separatism. The main thing, when I went to school, the main thing that I was taught, stay with them white girls and you'll be okay. So, but I just kept busy. I had no time for it. I went to school. I trained after school for wrestling. Then I used to leave that. I'd go to the Y and work out. Then I'd go home and eat and go to sleep. That was my whole schedule from age 16 till 20. That was my schedule.
Interesting. So if Rocky Johnson wasn't your favorite tag team partner, who would have been your favorite tag team partner over the years?
Tommy Wildfire Rich.
Because you guys got along outside the ring?
We were like brothers. Yeah, we were like brothers. And we were so good in the ring. I knew what Tommy going to do, and Tommy knew what I could do. We didn't even have to call a spot. We could read each other. He was my best tag team partner ever. I'll tell everybody that. Tommy Wildfire Rich.
Sin City wants to know, how was it working for the AWA? You were at the Showboat Hotel and conceded on a bunch of times. You asked this person once, I guess, to bring your wife into the dressing room, this fan, when he saw you in Las Vegas.
I don't remember. I told you I get old here.
Big moment for him, though.
Yeah. But for me, I mean, you know, how many times I went to the Showboat, how many times I had a wife, and how many times I went to the dressing room.
Another fan wants to know, how was your relationship with Vince McMahon backstage?
It was good. Me and Vince, we friends. It's just, you know, Vince just got no spot for me right now. He don't know what to do with me.
This is a funny question. Serrano, would you ever let a big girl walk on you?
Who?
Would you ever let a larger female walk on you?
I don't want no other.
Really?
You prefer? Yes. I like big women walking on me. What's wrong? Amanda Storm used to walk on me. She was 235 pounds.
Really?
Amanda Storm was a big girl. I got pictures of me and her stepping on me.
Wow. But you don't, like, I guess some people have said you actually
relieve yourself. Weird? They say I'm weird?
No, like, there's some stories, I guess the Honky Tonk Man has said it, that you'd actually relieve yourself when people walk on you. You don't.
How would Honky Tonk know?
I don't know.
See my point? You know what Honky Tonk just said? What he just did? He told a lie. See, a lot of wrestlers, we exaggerate things that they hear about. Because remember what I just told you? Heels and babyface was not what? Together. That's why I asked you, how would Honky Tonk know? I never hung out with Honky Tonk. I never did anything with Honky Tonk except for wrestling in the ring. He never hung out with me. See, a lot of wrestlers would tell you stuff. Mad Dog Vachon told me something about wrestling, telling stories. He said, if a story is worth telling, if worth embellishing.
Yeah, well, that's why I wanted to clear that
up. I relieve myself with vagina, not shoes.
Right. You just, like, kind of register the memory in your head, right?
No, the shoes, it's strange. It's non-sexual. That's why I could do it anywhere. It's non-sexual. It give me a feeling of humbleness. It's a balance. I get dominated by a woman for a few minutes, and it makes me more dominant in my life. Because everything I've been in, I dominate. I got into bodybuilding, I dominated it. I got into weightlifting, I dominated it. I got into amateur wrestling, I dominated it. I went into pro wrestling, I dominated it. When a woman is standing on, is the only time in my life where I'm not domineering. So it's a balance in my life.
That's cool with me. I have no issue.
That's why I could do it in person. You know, if it was sexual, I wouldn't do it in a gym. I wouldn't do it in a wrestling arena, for God's sake.
Yeah.
But that's how guys think about things. They think everything got a sexual component to it, when everything don't have a sexual component to it.
Rodrigo wants to know, what are your thoughts on JBL and the bullying accusations that he's had against him over the years?
Who?
Bradshaw from WWE.
Yeah, I thought it was a wimp. He was the biggest wimp that the wrestling world ever see. There was a guy called Joy Styles. He worked in the office, beat the crap out of him on an airplane coming back from Europe one day. What a big sissy Bradshaw was. It was all fake. He just a one big fake wimp. He couldn't even whoop his way out of a wet paper bag. He's soft as a grape.
Yeah, I think Joey
Styles whipped his ass. You know how big Joey Styles is?
Small.
Yeah, Joey Styles is probably about 5'6", 160 pounds. He beat up Bradshaw. Beat him halfway to death. The wrestler had to pull him off of him. He's all show. He's all mouth. He's a punk.
Ed from Queens tips you $5, and he wants to know if you have any George the Animal Steel stories.
He was a heel. See?
Yeah.
Y'all love asking a babyface about heels, huh? See, that's why it's hard to talk to this guy, because the favorite wrestler, what the people loved the most was the heels. We couldn't hang around them. I knew George was a stooge. He's office stooge. I knew that, but that's about it.
Me, another fan had a question earlier. Did you have a favorite agent to work with, or did you consider them all kind of stooges?
George Scott. I love George Scott. I love Ole Anderson. Ole Anderson was great to work with. George Scott. Chief J. Strongbow. I like the Chief. Tony Guerrero. I like Tony Guerrero. Fit Finley. I like Fit Finley. Rick and the Dragon Steamboat. I liked him. So there were some agents that I liked, but we knew who was the butthole. George Amistel always was a jerk. You know, he was a prick.
What about Steve Lombardi? He wasn't an agent, but he was a backstage guy.
I didn't spend a lot of time with Steve.
Ken wants to know your thoughts on Arnold Schwarzenegger, who I know you had some interaction with. You talk about it in your book.
Yeah, when Arnold was a great lifter, great person, loved to play jokes on people, loved to have a good time. And I have nothing bad to say about it. I don't have a lot of experience with it, because most of me and Arnold, we hung out, was either on the beach or at Santa Monica Beach, or we was at the gym. And we were in the gym, we didn't talk to each other. Arnold, we finished his workout, come over and talk about, call me triceps. I said, Tony, them triceps look like quadriceps. He said, you got quadriceps for triceps. You know, and Lou Ferrigno was the guy I spent most of my time with. I spent more time with Lou Ferrigno than I did with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
How was Lou?
Lou, and as long as you don't talk to him while he's working out, you got along great with him. But if you talk while you're working out around Lou, he won't nothing to do with you. He took his workout very, very seriously. But he was a great guy. I mean, he's still a great guy. You know, I got along real good with Lou Ferrigno.
James wants to know your thoughts on Billy Jack Haynes.
Billy Jack, I never met him a day in my life.
Really?
Never met him, never seen him in person a day in my life. I saw him in pictures, I saw him on TV, never met the man.
How was Hulk Hogan to deal with in WWE, a fan is asking?
Hogan was great. He's a great guy. I mean, he never did me no harm, always treated me like gold. In fact, I just did an artwork for Hulk Hogan. He asked me to draw a picture for his new beach shop down in Florida. I just did some artwork for Hulk Hogan. He's a wonderful friend, great friend.
What was the money like to wrestle Hogan back in the day? I guess you probably wrestled him when he was a heel.
Guys were making $8,000 a week on the undercard with Hogan. Hogan made a lot of people rich. In fact, if it wasn't for Hogan, there'd be no WCW, no WWE. I mean, that company owed Hogan a lot, brother, a lot. Think about what it would be without WrestleMania or Hulkamania. Think about it. I mean, no matter how much they want to shit on the guy now because they don't need him now, but nope, he popped this business. Hogan took wrestling from the high school gym to the Coliseum, brother. I mean, he put wrestling on the map. Think about it. He did more for wrestling than Bruno Sammartino or anybody. Nobody. I mean, this was all over the world. There was no sport bigger than wrestling until Hogan walked into that ring. I mean, come on now. This is the wrestling is Hulk Hogan. I mean, come on. Shit.
The Dirty Game Room wants to know, what was the Ultimate Warrior like? I know you guys were friends.
he was a good guy, good workout buddy, very cheerful, never was in a bad mood. You know, stayed to himself a lot. He didn't hang out with the boys much. Always stayed, it was always just him and his wife.
And what about Ole Anderson? How did you get along with him over the years? He's a very controversial guy.
Well, he only controversial to people that never played sport. Ole just reminded me of an old school coach. He shoot for the hip. He tell you what he think, you know, and he didn't beat around the bush. You know, he was a straight shooter. I mean, his tone was a little bit rough at times, but, you know, you're not talking to a kid. You're not talking to your wife. So Ole didn't feel that he needed to talk to a man the way he talked to a woman.
Red Nova wants to know your thoughts on D'Lo Brown.
Don't know him.
And how was working with Mark Henry when they brought you to work with him in WWE? I heard the rumor that they brought you in to kind of get him to lose weight because he was not keeping on that strict a diet.
True. That was true. They wanted me to put him on a bodybuilding program. So I started off as his trainer, and then later on, Vince made me his manager. But Mark Henry bought me a house. Got nothing good but to say about Mark Henry. He bought me a house. Being with Mark Henry gave me enough money to buy me and my wife a house. So thank you, Mark Henry.
Have you seen this Thunderdome thing in WWE that they're doing now?
I hadn't seen a wrestling match. The last wrestling match that I saw was in 1776. I don't watch it. I can't watch it. It come on too late, and it's more like the Oprah Winfrey show than wrestling. They talk too much. I don't want to hear all that talking.
They've apparently banned Billy Graham from the Thunderdome. Like there's pictures of fans watching wrestling now, and I guess Billy Graham, if a picture comes up, they'll immediately remove it. I guess he's still at
Superstar Billy Graham. You're talking about?
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
It just came out this week. That's why I was going to ask you if you were surprised, because he's been around for a long time and he did a lot for them. So it's strange they would ban his image from the Thunderdome.
Well, my mother had an old saying, you make your bed, you have to lie in it. So evidently, like I said, I don't know what's going on with them and Billy Graham, but if they ban you from the Thunderdome, evidently you did something for them to ban you. So you can't really look at the WWE. What did Billy do to them? That's what you got to look at. He had to do something. Vince just don't start banning you just for the hell of it, especially if he can make money off of it. Vince, you know, it's business with him. He didn't ban me. I did a lot of shit to Vince, but I did nothing to him that was so bad for him to ban me from everything.
He told me his legend deal expired in September, so it may have had to do with him not re-signing the legends deal. I don't know.
That ain't got nothing to do with them taking down his poster and stuff. There's a lot of guy things ran out. It's something Billy did that he's not telling you.
Monster tips you $2, and he's asking if you have any stories about Ricky Steamboat.
Yes.
Do you mind when sharing?
Not really. Nick, he's a clean cut guy, so it's hard to find a story on Ricky Steamboat. He was clean cut, like Bob Backlund. To tell a story about Bob Backlund, the only thing you can talk about is ring and his lifting. That's about it. Steamboat is a very clean living guy. He didn't party a lot. You know, he very faithful to his wife. Worked hard. Just a great guy, wonderful guy. Love him to death. But he's very clean cut.
Boring. There's a fan on here that wants to know, what did you think about Uncle Elmer? He had some heat backstage.
I like Uncle Elmer. Most times we just saw guys in the arena. We didn't go and hang out with them. So it's kind of hard to tell stories about these guys because we didn't really hang around them that much, you know?
And just to wind it down here, I thank you for your time. There's a couple fans on here that have asked about your thoughts on Ravishing Rick Rude.
I think Ravage Rick Rude would probably have been as big as Ric Flair or Hogan if, you know, if he hadn't had such a short career. One of the guys that people never ask about that I like to talk about was Magna T.A. That guy, if it hadn't been for that car accident, he would have been one of the best wrestlers this world ever seen. So there was a lot of guys that really had great, great potential. And that's the guy you should interview one day, is Magna T.A. People don't forget about that guy, but he was on a cover of a magazine. They said he was going to be the next Ric Flair. I mean, he would have been, he probably would have surpassed Ric Flair. Magna T.A., if he had lived, there probably would have been no Ric Flair. Because this guy was phenomenal, but they never put much focus. So if you go up and get a hold of Magna T.A., that's the guy that he could tell you a lot of stories too.
Yeah, I still haven't ran into him, but hopefully one day I will.
I think the fans will really enjoy that conversation because he was at the beginning of the WCW, all the big push when they were taking on Hulk Hogan. I've been taking on Vince McMahon. He was the guy that they was hoping to overrun WWE. So it probably would have happened if it wasn't for that car accident, you know. But that was a guy that everybody said, this is going to be the next world champion. I mean, everybody would say, this is going to be the next world champion. He was phenomenal. Phenomenal.
Monty Ham wants to know if you think Marty Jannetty killing the person is real or if that's Marty screwed up on whatever he
is. I don't even know if that's true or not. So it's hard for me to speak. Like I say, I don't like speaking on stuff that I can't really testify to. I mean, I just heard it like from, you know, different people. I don't even know if the story is true or not.
And if people want to book you for wrestling bookings or autograph appearances, not that there's many these days until this COVID is over, where can they contact you?
Well, they can always contact you. You know how to reach me.
I do.
Or they could contact Mike Hamilton. He know how to reach me. I'm not hard to find.
No. Well, if it wasn't for COVID, you were going to actually be back up in Canada this year, but unfortunately, we had to cancel all of our summer events.
Yeah. I felt bad about that. I was really looking forward because I had a wonderful time working with you last time I was up there.
Yeah, and you're still in good shape, but you're still alive. Thank God. Unlike
your age. That's the main thing. I'm still alive.
Yeah,
that's very important, you know. Well, I hope that maybe by summertime, maybe Hannibal, you bring me back up there.
I hope so. I'm praying that they're going to be back open by the summer. But I'm glad we were able to do this tonight, and the fans gave you some good tips. So I'm happy.
Well, you got to thank Mike Hamilton. If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't be doing this.
Well, the last question I'll ask you is, what's your advice for wrestlers today? Because I know there's a lot of wrestlers that watch this channel. What would you tell them to make wrestling better and make the industry more healthy?
I would tell them what the old timers told me. Look in the mirror and ask yourself, would you pay to see you? And if the answer is no, then you got work to do.
Very true. I agree with that. Excellent. Well, to wrap this up, I'll let you have the screen here to say whatever you want to close off this interview. Again, I always love talking to you. I consider you a friend, and I really appreciate you coming on.
Well, what I want to say is thank all you many, many fans around the world that have supported professional wrestling and kept up with me and encouraged me to continue on. And I love each and every one of y'all. And I hope that I'll be around long enough to meet some of my fans, some of the people that ask all them questions. I would love to meet you guys. And like I said, you contact Mike Hamilton or Hannibal, and they know how to get in contact with me. Anything I can do for you, fundraising, or if a kid birthday or a sickness in the family or whatever, if I can help anybody in this world, I'm here to offer my help. Trust in God. Believe in God. There's only one God. Do not forsake God. We need him more than we ever needed him before. Believe in your God. Good night.